I want to focus on those people who have Alzheimer's plus vascular. The vascular system is something that we've known about for a long time, and we know that what's good for the heart is good for the brain. So I want to go into a bit of a deep dive on that topic. This is the vascularization of the brain, all the blood vessels in the brain. And I love seeing this image, and it always kind of surprises me and astounds me that there is just so much blood pumping through our brains at any one time. And that's really important. This is another image showing an MRI of the brain and showing how branched those blood vessels are. And I like to think of it like trees, right? You have like a trunk and then you have branches, and those branches go into smaller branches. And ultimately we get down into little tiny twigs. And those are the little capillaries or microcapillaries of the brain. And when we have, either just with normal aging or more so if you have high cholesterol or hypertension, those little twigs get clogged, and ultimately the blood isn't getting to them. And then the little bit of brain that they are serving or supplying blood and oxygen and nutrients to dies off. And we get these little white matter changes in the brain. So the bottom image there is the white matter structure of the brain. And the white matter provides the kind of road system where how information moves around our brain. And that's one of the reasons why we think the brain becomes less efficient and speedy with age, because it's getting kind of clogged up, and the road system, the information getting from point A to point B has to go different circuitous routes, which takes longer and slows us down our processing speed and our attention and all of these kind of things. So small vessel disease of the kind we just described is very common with aging. It contributes to clinical decline, and it's associated with vascular risk factors like the ones I just mentioned, cholesterol and high blood pressure. Another major factor in clinical and cognitive decline with aging is inflammation. And this is, again, kind of non-specific, right? It's associated with all sorts of things, stress or diet, vascular risk, et cetera. And importantly, it seems to be really important in driving that tau pathology, the tau spread through the brain. And inflammation is present in brains. It's part of the healthy function of the brain, even when we're young, but it becomes more of a prevalent process as we get older, and even more so in Alzheimer's disease. As you can see from these PET scans from colleagues in Pennsylvania at the bottom, where the redness of the picture is the higher level of inflammation in the brain. But let's talk a little bit about who is at risk for Alzheimer's disease. So there are certain non-modifiable risk factors. And as Danielle mentioned, a lot of my research is in sex differences, and I particularly hone in on women. And that is in part because being female is a major risk factor for Alzheimer's disease. And there's not much we can do to change that. But another non-modifiable risk factor, unfortunately, is race. So you'll see in this image from the CDC that if you're over 65 in this country and you're a non-Hispanic white, you have about a 10% chance of having Alzheimer's disease. If you're Hispanic, it's 12%. And if you're African-American, it's 14%. So there's a definite difference in risk based on race and ethnicity for various reasons. The other factor is genetic. And again, that goes in the non-modifiable category. But today's talk is really focused on modifiable risk factors. What can we change, and how can we improve our cognitive aging? So this is increasingly recognized as being really important. It might not change the initial pathology, the amyloid, although we think that maybe some things can, but it can perhaps change the vascular and inflammatory factors that promote the spread of tau, delaying onset or reducing severity. Two things that we're looking to do with modifiable risk factors are to add the resistance to pathology, so not getting the pathology in the first place, or getting it later than you would otherwise, or a reserve against cognitive effects. So having the pathology in the brain, but it not mattering so much, it not being such a problem for us cognitively. And it's important to note that a lot of people will die with a head full of amyloid and never have any cognitive concerns or problems. So it's really that tau pathology that becomes problematic and something that we want to avoid or diminish in its effect. What am I talking about when I say modifiable risk factors? So there was a really important paper that came out in the Lancet called the Lancet Commission in 2020 by Gil Livingstone. And she and her colleagues did a large review of the evidence and derived this beautiful plot, which shows that 40% of the risk for Alzheimer's disease and dementia more broadly is modifiable. And some of that is related to early life experiences, specifically education. 7% of the risk is maintained by the amount and quality of education you have when you're young. And that's really important for policy setting, and it's important for making sure our kids and our grandkids go to school and get a good education, but it doesn't help us much when we're adults. But other things do. So the midlife blue circle there shows things like hearing loss, hypertension, drinking too much alcohol, obesity. And then we get into this later life section in the purple, where we have depression, socialization, physical inactivity, diabetes, and the cumulative risk associated with all of those things can compromise a large chunk of our individual risk for getting dementia. So that's encouraging, right? Because there are things that we can do about those. A lot of those targets are really actionable and things that we can do something about. Of course, the actual risk factors are really personal, and the combination of risk factors that any one person has is going to be a little bit different. So as we're talking today, as we're going through this talk, think about what your personal risk might be, things that you might be able to improve, and maybe you don't have anything, which is fantastic. But if you do, then maybe you can start like making a little list of things that you might want to target in the future. So sex differences, again, this is kind of the lifeblood of my research. And as I mentioned, women have a much higher risk of dementia, and it's not just because we live longer. But unfortunately, 2/3 of Americans living with Alzheimer's disease are women. And women also have a different kind of trajectory of Alzheimer's disease than do men, where they have a third, like burgeoning of tau pathology during the mild cognitive impairment or MCI phase, which happens between when we have normal cognition, but before when we have dementia and we're dependent on others for help. So when we have some cognitive difficulties, but we're still independent. And women also have a robust and responsive immune system, which puts us at higher risk for other inflammatory disorders which affect the body and the brain, things like multiple sclerosis, rheumatoid arthritis, and lupus. So along with my colleagues, especially Erin Sunderman, I'm interested in whether inflammation could be the key to the surge in tau. And if we can understand that, maybe it can help us learn how to restrict or slow the spread of tau. So for example, this is some work done by our former postdoc, Rachel Gurnia, who looked at neuroinflammatory factors, specifically something called STNFR2, in the cerebrospinal fluid. So that's the fluid that fills the spaces in the brain, cushions the brain, and also coats our spinal cord. And when we look at that fluid, we can see a lot about what's going on in the brain. And what we found is that women show a much stronger link between cognition, in this case, something called the MMSE or the mini mental status exam, and inflammation, in this case, a marker called STNFR2. Whereas men who are in the light gray in that graph really don't show a relationship. So there's something going on with women where there's a stronger relationship. And we see it in other things too, with things like tau pathology, which was included actually in Rachel's paper, where women showed a relationship between inflammation and tau, whereas men did not. So there's something going on there, which was very motivating to myself and my colleague, Dr. Erin Sunderman, here she is. And it led us to produce a study, which is ongoing, called the Women, Inflammation, and Tau Study, or WITS. And in this study, we're looking just at women, and we're looking at whether modifiable risk factors, specifically sleep apnea, exercise, and insulin resistance, might predict Alzheimer's disease outcomes, specifically cognition and tau, and whether inflammation is a mediator of that, like something that pushes that relationship.